new Khan.
My name is Khan. I'm a private detective.
Chinatown, San Francisco, an exotic world, an unusual man, Khan.
Next Friday night on CBS.
Los Angeles police tonight release another suspect in the slasher murder series after finding the ninth victim. We'll also have a complete report on that, and fog means...
Details on Channel 2 News at 11.
I'm Kathy.
I'm Buck.
I have the only nonstop DC-10s and the most flights to Miami.
We're going to fly you like you've never been flown before.
Fly Buck and Kathy. Fly National.
Hello, I'm Lauren Green, and I want to tell you about a remarkable new wild animal series, Lorne Greene's Last of the Wild. In journeys to the corners of the earth, we'll explore animals unique in the history of time. And I'd like to invite you to watch Lorne Greene's Last of the Wild.
Alice and Russ are expecting their first grandchild. They're ready.
There's going to be a girl.
They qualified for a United account at UCB. Their check guarantee card made shopping easy. Their master charge will get them back east to see their new granddaughter or grandson. And they get free traveler's checks. The United account. It can do a lot for you. Alice and Russ, maybe it'll be twins. United California Bank. The best banking ideas in town or your money back.
Dan Rather with the latest election returns. The results of the 1974 congressional races. Not the votes. They were counted back in November, of course, and the new Congress is now in session. What's still being counted is the money. Perhaps $80 million in campaign funds.
New York is up to $21,057.14.
Today, January 31st, is the deadline for the final returns from all candidates on their finances, how much they spent, where they got it. A preliminary count indicates that almost 20% of the total came from organizations representing some special interest, dispensing funds in five or six figures in the name of business, labor, or some professional group. All of this means that while the close relationship between big money and politics is changing, it's a long way from breaking up. That's what we make of the figures, and here's the way we'll show it to you in a kind of voters and taxpayers edition of the campaign funds report. First, by way of background, from Teddy Roosevelt to Watergate, how political campaigning came to be such a big money affair.
12 years ago.
Second, in two significant races last fall, the rising importance of the special interest groups, their special relationship with the incumbents of both parties. Third, the movement toward reform, how far it has come in presidential campaigning, how far it still has to go where Congress is concerned.
The working title of this broadcast is The Best Congress Money Can Buy. Given your experience, do you think that's an overstatement?
No, unfortunately, I'm afraid that is an accurate type of statement. I think the worst evil is the fact that you have to get your money usually large amounts from certain special interest groups. And I think when you do that, they feel they have a hold on you, and to a certain extent, they do.
American Motors announces the biggest rebate plan of the Big Four, up to $600. You make your best deal on a new 1975 AMC Gremlin, and AMC will send you $200 cash if you take delivery by February 28th. Or on the Hornet X or Hornet DL, it's $400 back. And if you buy a Cassini Matador, we'll write you a check for $600. AMC gives you the biggest rebate plan of the Big Four. So see your AMC dealer now.
You can tell I'm a nature lover, but can you also tell I wear dentures? I do. And because I prefer things that are natural, I use Fast Teeth Denture Adhesive Powder. There's nothing synthetic about it. It's 100% natural. What's more, it gives my dentures a natural feeling, so comfortable, they almost seem like my own teeth. And Fast Teeth holds firm, so I can enjoy hard-to-eat foods with less worry.
Fast Teeth.
Firm hold with that natural feeling.
Election night, 1974. The payoff of the campaign for the 94th Congress. If we'd been counting dollars and cents that evening instead of votes, you'd have heard facts and figures like these. The Democrats collected and spent more money this time than the Republicans, about $45 million to $35 million. There were four Senate candidates, one Republican, three Democrats, with million-dollar campaign chests. There were seven candidates for the House who raised at least $200,000 apiece. These figures mark the latest plateau in the steady escalation of campaign finances. It's a historic spiral, not of inflation, but of technology. And it's been on the rise for decades.
The principles for which we stand are the principles of fair play.
There was a time, Teddy Roosevelt's time, when campaigning was mostly talk. And talk was cheap before they started sending it coast to coast. Back then, campaign technology consisted of the flag and the handshake. To beat Teddy Roosevelt in 1912, it took Woodrow Wilson and $1 million. Wilson tried to raise the money from the public, failed, and fell back on the resources of some rich men. One of them was Bernard Baruch of Wall Street. The next time out, in 1916, Wilson went straight to the fat cats. One large contribution came from Henry Ford of Detroit. Another from E.L. Doheny, the oil man who later promoted the scandalous deal of Teapot Dome.
New York is yours. I don't give it to you. You want it.
For campaigners in the 20s, the ante was raised, and this is what did it, radio. Still a little newfangled to Al Smith several years later. Newfangled and expensive.
Bear in mind that the cheering all comes out of the radio time.
These plans, like so many other plans.
By the mid-30s, as used by Franklin D. Roosevelt, radio had become the most effective campaign instrument. By the 40s, an absolute essential.
Land of freedom in all this world.
Harry Truman's uphill campaign in 1948 got a boost from a last-minute radio speech, paid for by passing the hat in New York restaurants. The bill was $25,000. 4 years later, the Republicans paid $75,000 to let the voters see and hear their vice presidential candidate.
But Pat and I have the satisfaction that every dime that we've got is honestly ours. I should say this, that Pat doesn't have a mink coat. But she does have a respectable Republican cloth coat. And I always tell her that she'd look good in anything.
With television arrived the era of political free spending.
If people can afford less butter, less fruit, less bread, less milk, yes, it's time for a change.
It was not just the cost of the broadcasts themselves, but also the expanding staffs of high-priced specialists with their production techniques, their marketing techniques, their PR and advertising techniques.
On October 24th, 1963, Barry Goldwater said of the nuclear bomb, merely another weapon. Merely another weapon.
In the 60s, aroused by the social legislation of the New Frontier and Great Society, a new breed of fat cat came forward, the organized interest group, offering financial help to candidates for Congress who would resist the wave of programs. Medicare was the first big target, attacked by the American Medical Association with a political action committee dispensing millions in campaign funds. Meanwhile, the unions were helping to finance candidates who favored their legislative aims. Campaign techniques kept expanding and campaign costs kept rising. You had to be loaded, as Will Rogers once pointed out, even to get beat. And not just for the presidency. Rockefeller. A New York Democrat spent $4 million on a losing race for the Senate. In California, a candidate dropped $2 million without getting past the primary.
Norton Simon,
Republican.
By the 70s, political campaigning had acquired all the elements of a big-time professional sport. Competition, audience, media, and big money. 1972, the year of Watergate, that climax in the long affair between money and campaign politics. Both sides had their fat cats, individuals contributing sums up to $2 million for their candidate, plus contributors like these, the United Auto Workers, $307,000 for McGovern, the Communications Workers, $223,000. From the Seafarers Union, Nixon got $100,000, and from the Teamsters, at least $38,000. From the milk producers, $727,000. At the Republican Operations Center, the committee to re-elect the president, campaign finance reached new peaks of sophistication in the soliciting of funds and laundering them, processing them in such a way as to conceal the sources. Some of the money was contaminated, some downright illegal, as the Watergate hearings and prosecutions would show.
Watergate complex and the alleged cover-up that followed.
Mr. Mitchell, if you'll stand up, I'll administer the oath.
The scandal of Watergate was the financing of an election campaign with tainted contributions, tainted by the expectation of favors or influence in behalf of individuals like Robert Vesco, of companies in the oil industry, defense industry, the airlines business, in behalf of groups like the milk producers. It was financed at a profit, which was used for non-campaign purposes, personal expenses, payments to the Watergate defendants once the lid blew off. What the 1972 campaign seemed to show was that politics itself, the very soul of the system, politics was being bought out, the people sold out. There is nothing all that new about politicians and contributors breaking the campaign laws. It was the sheer totality of the thing, the systematic use of pressure and misuse of funds, that made the Watergate violations hard to ignore. What has changed since Watergate? Well, first of all, the activity you see around me. The candidate's reporting procedure, which took effect during the 72 campaign, is being monitored now by civic organizations like the one that runs this information center, the Citizen Research Foundation, also by Common Cause, and through these facilities, by the press. For the first time, some public light is being shined into the campaign vaults. And for the first time, there have been important prosecutions. So candidates and contributors have been put on notice that violations will be taken seriously. All of which has had a definite effect on post-Watergate campaign politics, though not all of it to the good, as could be seen in the 1974 congressional elections.
Viva, the towel that's known for its absorbency, is challenging another absorbent paper towel in a different kind of test, scrubbing with an abrasive cleanser.
Okay.
Viva keeps right on working. Viva didn't fall apart. Viva, the absorbent paper towel that keeps on working.
Announcing the 1975 chuck wagon, a new model of an old favorite. It has the same standard equipment, Conestoga wheels, oak wagon bed. But this year, it's better tasting because we've beefed up the flavor. New chuck wagon chunky beef flavored dog food. There's beef flavored chunks, crunchier nuggets, and a richer broth. The chuck wagon you've been waiting for.
Chuck wagon chunky beef flavor. Take a test chase today.
In the 1974 congressional campaign, the candidates hired halls and brought in political guest stars to endorse them, all expenses paid. They ran up bills for the food and drinks, bills for printing, payrolls for their staffs. They ran up travel expenses getting around the campaign circuit. They bought space along the roads as well as in the papers. They bought time on the air to get their message to voters.
Government is big business. To many, it seemed so far away.
Congressman Frank M. Clark is as near as your phone.
When disaster strikes, it's important to have someone in Washington who really cares. Senator Birch Bayh cares. And Birch Bayh.
Who picked up the tab for this $80 million political spending spree? Where did the money come from? Not so much this time from well-heeled individuals. Watergate had scared off some of the fat cats. But the gap was more than covered by organized blocks of contributors, the special interest groups. The biggest of the big-time political spenders were the American Medical Association, the labor conglomerate, the AFL-CIO, an independent union, the United Auto Workers, a maritime union, the Marine Engineers Beneficial Association. Farther down the list were the National Education Association, the teachers' lobby, the National Association of Manufacturers, the big business group. Altogether, perhaps 20% of the campaign funds were supplied by organizations representing business, labor, professions, by civic groups, ideological groups, and one-shot causes. In congressional campaigns, the fat cats are traveling in packs.
This is a special interest group, MEBA, the Marine Engineers Beneficial Association, a small outfit with a big investment in the United States Congress. It's one of a loose coalition of maritime unions with beachheads along the New York waterfront. Across the street there is the headquarters of MEBA's main ally, the Seafarers International. The jobs are out on the ships, mostly tankers and freighters that berth in the coastal ports and Great Lakes. Between them, the two unions have something under 100,000 members. But between them, they spent well over $500,000 on the 1974 congressional elections. Money contributed by working engineers and seamen, and also by retired union members. By law, political contributions are supposed to be strictly voluntary. But some of the union members we talked to had obviously been conned or strong-armed.
And I went up to the dispatcher who does the hiring, and he said I owed an initiation fee and 2 or 3 years quarterly dues and some fines for being late paying the dues. And the bill got up into the hundreds and hundreds of dollars. It finally got close to $1,000, as I recall. So I told him there was no way that I could afford to pay that. And he said, well, let's talk more about, say, $300. Could you contribute that to our political fund? Or he had some figure, and I told him, well, I couldn't afford that. And I sort of bartered him down until we reached a figure of $160. I gave him the $160, and he gave me these receipts, which shows that I had contributed to the political fund. And that's pretty much how it went. And then the next day, I got a ship.
Do you know anybody else who had similar experiences?
It goes on all the time. I've heard every time you pay your union dues, they try to get another chunk of money to go into their political fund.
Union officials simply dodged all of our requests to discuss this whole subject, including how the funds were used. In fact, the money was distributed mainly to incumbent senators and congressmen who cast key votes in favor of a bill the unions were pushing hard. This was the controversial Energy Transportation Security Act, requiring that a fixed percentage of all oil imported into this country be carried on American ships manned by American crews. This would guarantee more jobs to the unions, but at an estimated cost of 2 cents a gallon in higher fuel prices, or $60 a year to the average family, $315 million to the inflated economy. Which is why consumer groups and good government groups fought the bill, and why President Ford killed it by refusing to sign it after it had passed Congress. The special interest and the public interest, in other words, are sometimes miles or millions apart.
This stretch of the Ohio River is a couple of hundred miles inland. But it was another maritime union beachhead. Not in membership, no more than a handful working the tugs and barges, but in political influence. This was the bailiwick of Frank M. Clark, one of MEBA's favorite congressmen.
Now, I just want to show you what all we have here. It's very necessary that you have someone, I think, in Washington, D.C., that understands the complex problems we have of our Ohio River.
For 10 straight terms, the congressman from the 25th District in western Pennsylvania, Frank Clark was running for his 11th. This was one of two campaigns we covered last fall in terms of finances. Not where did the money go, but where did it come from and why? To his constituents, Clark's name was identified with personal service, a traditional kind of style, and a penchant for giving away flags in all forms and sizes.
This flag, which will fly, I am sure, over top of this building for
to students of campaign financing, Clark represented something else, an example of how special interests and the party in power serve to reinforce each other, or the gravy flows toward the incumbent.
In 1972, the record shows, as best I can make it out, that the Marine Engineers contributed something on the order of $1,000 to your campaign. Now, I don't want to hold you to the figures here. In 1974, when it appeared you'd have a much easier race, they gave you well above $10,000. Why the difference?
The difference is that I'm now the chairman of the subcommittee, and I'm the one that's introducing the bills, I'm the one that's holding the hearings, and of course they're very much interested in keeping our maritime afloat, and so naturally they're going to give me more money.
Do you have to go to unions such as the Marine Engineers or the Seafarers and ask them for money in any way, shape, or form now, or do they come to you?
No, I don't. I don't have to. They call me up and they say, could you use a little money? Can you use a little campaign funds? And I always tell them yes. In fact, I don't think I've ever said no.
Congressman, round figures. What does it take these days to run a first-rate congressional election campaign if one has a primary?
If I was starting over again, right today, I know I would have to spend $150,000. First of all, it would be in advertising, in the newspapers, radio, and TV, to get my name across to the people.
We don't need as much as Frank needs. We can beat him with significantly less than what he's going to put into it. But you've got to put people... I had a fellow say...
Clark's opposition had nothing like big money to promote their candidate, Gary Myers, a 37-year-old Republican with some friends, but no power base.
As of yet, we haven't received anything from the local Republican committee, and the private donations have amounted to $2,290. Our present balance in our checking account is $1,045.29.
The finances of this campaign, I think, are a lot like the campaigning part of the campaign. We've got to make our own way.
Candidate Myers is a political semi-pro, campaigning on leave of absence from his job as production foreman in a steel mill. He ran against Clark before in 72 and lost, even with the Nixon landslide in his favor. This year would be an uphill climb for Republicans, especially non-incumbents. The 25th is a small town district in which media means not television, but radio and newspapers. But while the incumbent was sponsoring broadcasts of high school football games, the challenger had to carry his message to the voters by hand.
No, I'm Gary Myers. I'm a candidate for the United States Congress.
Oh.
I appreciate your consideration to go to vote this year. You go to the polls this year?
Yes.
You registered?
Absolutely.
Fine. Appreciate your consideration. Your vote.
We will. Right.
Thank you very much.
Uh-huh.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Myers had appealed to the Republican National Committee for help. They came through with a minimal $2,500. The state committee, $500 more. He figured he could make up for his money shortage with legwork if he picked the right spots. This wasn't one of them. Myers' campaign manager was his wife, Elaine. The Myers campaign office, their kitchen.
Okay. What's happening really now is we have such a volunteer task force organized that they're continually asking for supplies. I had to order 20,000 extra candidate cards today, which really just pushes us further in debt. But it's kind of weighing odds. I don't want to discourage all the volunteers who are waiting for the supplies. As long as we can keep them with supplies and keep the enthusiasm of volunteers as high as it is, I don't think we
The low budget is going to hurt us that much.
It's risky. I'd much rather have a higher one than you. But
well, we're going to experience a sort of a new feature tomorrow. This luncheon that we have tomorrow is actually the first sort of luncheon along that line. It's a fundraising luncheon in Elwood at a country club. So I'm looking forward to it because not only is it should it be productive from a finance standpoint for us, but it is a new venture for us, and I'm sure that it's going to be a good affair. We can build the 40 ships that Mr. Clark would like to build at $4 billion, but that's not going to guarantee that we're going to have the oil. The crisis that we faced last...
The energy bill and Frank Clark's special interest money, a campaign theme sounded by the candidate and his finance chairman, a local real estate man named Tom Murray.
I feel that Frank Clark must be removed from office. Very, very few people are located in the 25th district that are financially supporting the incumbent candidate. And most of those funds are going to come from without this district. They're going to come from people that are in the Seafarers Union, from the National Maritime Union, for example, that gave $12,500, and from a number of other individuals that are closely related to the longshoremen's groups and other special interest groups.
I don't want to think because I'm showing $10,000 from maritime engineers that there's anything wrong with it, because I get a lot of money from the business people in my own community, and they're like $200, $150.
What do they expect to get for that money?
I think everyone has a reason. I'm talking about unions or business people. And that reason to me is that they want to keep that congressman here. I don't think that they want to figure, well, tomorrow I'm going to have a contract going through the Defense Department and Frank Clark's going to help me. I just absolutely don't believe that's true.
Next election, if someone came in with $500,000 or better, could he beat you?
I think my reputation is well known. I don't think he could beat me. Because, as I said earlier, I am sending out around 300 letters a day from my office here, personal first-class mail. Everything that goes out of here is Dear John, Dear Margaret, or Dear Jim. And it is a personal letter to everyone. I have a newsletter that goes out four or five times a year, telling what I do, how many bills I introduce or co-sponsor.
This came to our home just this past weekend, and what it is a letter from the congressman mailed to us free of charge of the congressman under the franking privilege. And for me as a challenger to just duplicate that mailing, in other words, to get one letter to each voter, each of the 200,000 voters in the district, would cost me in excess of $20,000. Yet the congressman, as the incumbent, can frank the mail into the constituents' homes right within a month away from the election.
I couldn't afford to stay here if I had to. Everything that went out of my office was paid for by stamps. As we just told you, that we sent out 160,000 newsletters just recently. We got under the deadline by about 2 or 3 weeks of not allowing to have your newsletter go out before the general election. You have 1 month before. Mm-hmm. And we got under that by 2 or 3 weeks so it wouldn't look too political. But anything that we send out on election year, why the papers and the news media and everyone else says it's politics.
That's what we're faced against, and many people don't understand what we say when we talk about the power of the incumbency. And that is one item. Other items are that an incumbent can often walk into a service group or organization or a radio and be interviewed as the incumbent, whereas a challenger never gets those opportunities or gets far fewer opportunities.
My friends all, I'm very proud to be your congressman representing you today.
I've had people say to me, well, you're not in government, and the congressman is in government, and he is here to explain what government is and how it works.
Mayor, I'm very happy to present this bicentennial...
For the incumbent, the dollars and cents part of the campaign was over long before the rest of it. His books balanced, his basic campaign expenses underwritten, in effect, by the Maritime Union's contributions. As for the challenger himself, Only weeks before the election, he was still in the red, still on the prowl for votes and money both.
My name's Jerry Marsh.
For the Republican challenger in another campaign, in the state of Indiana, it was a different game with better odds. As a candidate for the Senate, Richard Lugar was gambling for higher stakes, but as a big city mayor, he had a financial base to start from. And far from a political unknown, he was a proven vote-getter and money winner, a man listed in his party's presidential futures. The same for his opponent, Birch Bayh.
This is Julia Carson, the state legislator.
How you going?
I see. How you be?
Hi, how you going?
Bayh had a national reputation as a liberal activist and all the advantages of a powerful incumbent senator, including that useful political instrument, the franking privilege. For a senator, that figured to be worth around $500,000. This would be one of the most expensive campaigns in the country, with both candidates attracting special interest money from various sources and in high figures.
Your husband isn't going to believe that grocery bill, Dottie.
Alice, have you got something for a headache?
Have I got something for a headache?
Vanquish is strong medicine. Vanquish has more pain relievers than the largest selling extra strength tablet, and it has two buffers.
I don't believe this grocery bill. Have you got something for a headache?
Have I got something for a headache?
When you have headache pain, Vanquish is strong medicine.
Ford breaks things wide open with no-nonsense cash rebates up to $500 on America's best-selling lineup of new 1975 small cars. No weekly cutoffs, no trade-in requirements. $500 when you buy or lease a Mustang 2 Ghia. $500 on Mach 1. $300 on other Mustang 2s. $350 on supercab pickups. $200 on any Pinto or Maverick. Get your Ford dealer's best deal now. Then get a cash rebate from Ford. Value. See your Ford dealer.
Some idiot probably spent a lifetime making his lighter feel good in your hand. Big deal. But for $1.49 and thousands of lights, it's a pretty good lighter. Big butane.
This lighter comes in a lot of colors, like white, orange, yellow, blue, and green. But it isn't avocado green. Anyway, for $1.49 and thousands of lights, it's a pretty good lighter. Big butane.
Personally, I don't smoke. But for $1.49 and thousands of lights, it's a pretty good lighter. Big butane.
Is Coronet bathroom tissue soft as a baby's ear? Ask the experts.
I sit a lot. Softness is important to me. Coronet's very soft.
As a woman, I like Coronet's fragrance and softness.
I say Coronet's very soft.
Value is what I like about Coronet. Big value and softness.
Thank you, panel. You've made this a very soft job. Coronet Ultra 4 bath tissue from Georgia-Pacific. Soft as a baby's ear.
Politics in Indiana. Republican Richard Lugar campaigning for the Senate against the Democratic incumbent Birch Bayh. The style may be folksy, but the financing behind it was pretty sophisticated. High-powered enough to generate over $1 million for the Lugar campaign, not much less for his opponent.
A difference for this country.
It's time we had a senator for Indiana. It's Indianapolis, our Hoosier capital, where a lot of very good things have happened since a young man named Lugar went to work as mayor.
As a Senate candidate, Lugar may have been an outsider, but here in Indianapolis, as mayor of the state capital, he was an incumbent himself with the resources that come with power. And in Indiana, where politics has been developed into a profit-making industry, in this state, the resources are something special. Every Indiana license plate was money in the bank for candidate Lugar. About a nickel of the registration fee going not to the state, but to the party in power. One out of three state employees is a political appointee. And by rigid tradition, 2% of a year's salary is kicked back to the party treasury. A twist on the old spoils system. It was introduced by the Democrats in the 30s. It is now being challenged. But meanwhile, it produced a $500,000 base for the Lugar Senate campaign. Another important source of Lugar funds, well over $100,000, was the groups of down-home businessmen organized as the Circle Club and the Hoosier Associates. The members pay upwards of $1,000 a year. Many of them do business with the city or state. Party officials insist there is no quid pro quo.
The federal law provides that you cannot accept a contribution or in exchange for a promise of a contract or a promise for something from government. And we don't do that.
Well, now, human nature being what it is, are you telling me that in Indiana it does a businessman no particular good to be a member of the Hoosier Club?
It does a businessman some good to be a member. For instance, if you were manufacturing snowplows that only can be used on interstate highways, you've only got one customer. That's a governmental unit. Now, that type of an individual obviously is interested in finding out who it is who makes those decisions. And we give them an opportunity to meet that person, along with all of his other competitors to sell snowplows. Now, I think we'll go one step further. Do we furnish lists to the people in state government who are making the day-to-day decisions on whether they buy from contractor A or contractor B? We do not furnish those lists. Those lists are non-existent in those offices. We do answer inquiries as to whether or not an individual has been friendly to the party. And we endeavor to furnish that information.
Hoosier business and Hoosier politics were by far the main sources of Richard Lugar's support. But his positions on national issues produced some revenue from interests based outside the state.
I've also received about $15,000 from the political wing of the American Medical Association and $10,000 from the political wing of the real estate boards and other realtors. These are the largest block grants of money, and they're substantial. In a $1 million campaign, they amount, I suppose, to the corresponding percentages.
But what do the real estate people want for their money? What do they expect to get for their money? Nobody gives you $10,000 without expecting to get something for it.
Well, I think they anticipate that I will be a spokesman, be a fairly active one, for free enterprise, for free markets. Real estate interests thrive in free markets and with free enterprise. I would think that in the case of the Medical Association, they see monumental debates coming down the pike. They appreciate my stance in favor of individual freedom, of opportunities for people to develop their professional skills with the fewest inhibitions, and I'm certain that they like that idea.
Mayor, you've made a number of charges about the financing of Senator Bayh's campaign. Could you detail those for us, in brief, what you consider to be the most important?
The number of the votes that he has cast in the Senate, the most recent and questionable on the Maritime Act, seem to be dictated by ties to union interests that really were not represented in this state, or to union interests that had a more national focus and really were less useful to people here in Indiana.
To be specific about that, you're talking about the Marine Engineers.
Yes. And it just seemed to me to be curious that almost simultaneous with this vote, that a contribution of $2,500 was received by him.
Birch Bayh, honestly, candidly, straightforwardly, would you have gotten that money if you hadn't voted for the bill?
I don't know, honestly and straightforwardly. I'm inclined to think I would have, for the very reason that there are a number of other issues like the right to collective bargaining and this kind of thing that are very important to all the members of the trade union movement, that I have been on the side of the working men and women and their organizations. To me, there were a number of aspects of that vote. You were talking about not only American workers on American-made ships and American workers building American ships, you were talking about securing the supply of oil. And just as I don't like the Arabs to blackmail us and shut off our oil supply, I don't want those that have the flags of our ships to shut off our oil supply. So when I made the decision to vote for that bill, it was on that basis, more than on the number of jobs involved for the members of that given union.
In Bayh's finances, if not his legislative decisions, the labor unions played a key role. The maritime unions themselves, by the end of the campaign, contributed not just that $2,500, but more like $10,000. The United Auto Workers, $45,000. And with it, a personal endorsement by the national president, Leonard Woodcock.
You send him back to the Senate of the United States. Let's make November 5th D-Day, V-Day, People's Day.
More labor money for Birch Bayh from the AFL-CIO, about $90,000, contributed through its national committee called COPE, the Committee on Political Education. Also through its state committee and affiliated unions, electrical workers and garment workers and machinists. To elect Birch Bayh, labor chipped in about $140,000 all in all. A state official of the UAW.
We're in politics not because we want to be, but we have to be to survive. We have gotten legislation in Indiana, for example, union shop, and then they passed a right to work law in the state, which negated some of those provisions. SUB, they made it illegal in Indiana at one time. And so to protect what we gain at the bargaining table, we simply have to be in politics.
Interest groups on the opposite side, like the State Medical Association, make much the same kind of argument for their political activity.
I think within the present framework that physicians must have a political action committee, as almost every union does, the teachers do, business and industry does, and on and on through most groups in the country. I would not expect us to influence Senator Lugar's vote any more than I would expect Senator Bayh to change his vote for a substantial labor contribution that he might have.
I am Leonard Woodcock, president of the UAW. The UAW in Indiana endorsed both Senator Birch Bayh.
What the unions did for Birch Bayh, above and beyond the money, was a campaign within a campaign.
Ms. Young, we'll have a driver come out right now to pick you up.
Union members rounded up potential Bayh voters to get them registered. All of this activity directed by law, not at the general public, but only at union members and their families. All of this paid for out of union dues. But none of it counted as a contribution to the candidate, no matter how much it was worth to him. Birch Bayh's campaign manager, Jason Berman.
Now, you know that opponents say Birch Bayh is bought, paid for, and delivered for organized labor. Looking at the figures, 17% of his financial base, or thereabouts, in the campaign, plus what labor was willing and did on their own for him. Is that a fair statement?
No.
Why not?
Because I don't believe Birch Bayh can be bought by organized labor or anybody else. It's not a question of being bought. If you're asking me why is it that organized labor supports Birch Bayh, well, I think you just have to say that Birch Bayh has stood for some things and voted for some things that they may believe in. And if it's their right to support him.
Certainly. But what I was getting at, do they get anything more than that from Birch Bayh?
No.
For example, if a decision is made at the George Meany level that organized labor wants to oppose, let us say, the nominations to the Supreme Court of Haynesworth or a Carswell, do they have the influence, the power, to call a Birch Bayh and say, we want to oppose this nomination, and we want you to lead that fight?
Mr. Rather, if you recall the circumstances surrounding nominations of Haynesworth and Carswell, neither George Meany, nor John L. Lewis, nor Philip Murray, nor the strongest labor leader that we've ever had in the United States could have prevailed upon anybody to assume those roles, given the circumstances. They were unwinnable fights at the beginning, and the only reason that Birch Bayh got involved in those were reasons of conscience.
You're saying to me that no organized labor does not, as a result of its contributions to Bayh campaigns, have the power to call him and say, this is the kind of thing we want you to do, do it.
No, if they had that ability, they would have gotten Birch Bayh to vote for the Lockheed loan. They would have gotten Birch Bayh to vote for the SST, and he didn't. It's just not there. It's just not there.
You never can measure, except in the rarest instances, whether special interest money, quote, buys a vote.
Fred Wertheimer of Common Cause.
In combination with making contribution is trying to make things happen or to prevent things from happening. It takes place in a very complicated, harassed, busy system. Most people assume that an elected representative either is for or against something. That's not the case. Most time, the elected official hasn't thought about it, hasn't made his position on it, and more often than not, he has an open position. In that kind of situation, it's much easier for the interest group to get a response and for the individual to respond to the interest group. It is not forcing someone to change. It's getting that place in front of the line. It's getting access to talk to them about it. It's getting a sympathetic ear to your problems. Now, that simple entree can make all the difference in the world in a final result.
As the special interests come to the fore, the day of the fat cats is ending. And this event may have been one of their last hurrahs. In this audience, there were men who had given $2,000 or $3,000 or more. Some had paid an extra $500 a couple to attend a crowded pre-dinner reception for the guest of honor. An ex-congressman who, incidentally, got over $8,000 from the maritime unions the last time he ran in 1972. Ex-Congressman Gerald Ford.
Thank you very, very much. I thank you because you're here to elect Dick Lugar to the United States Senate. There's a lot of hard political muscle out to beat him. There's a lot of outstate money involved in trying to defeat Dick. But with your help, Dick Lugar can make it, and he deserves it.
On election day in Indiana, with campaign workers on both sides getting in their last licks, candidate Richard Lugar was defeated by Senator Birch Bayh. Business money and AMA money by labor money. Lugar's million-dollar campaign was not enough to overcome Bayh's incumbency plus $860,000.
Gary Myers,
thank you.
How are you, sir?
Yeah, eight part nobody gets.
In the 25th Congressional District of Pennsylvania, the challenger, Gary Myers, had picked up some momentum in the final stretch of the campaign. With money from his new friends in the business community, with a late boost of $5,000 from the Republican National Committee, Myers got his message into the media, an attack on Congressman Frank Clark and his special interest funds.
And here is your check for the days to get that vote out for us. And we do appreciate it.
The incumbent coasted toward the finish line, distributing the last of $10,000 worth of kits and another $10,000 in checks for his paid poll workers. On election day in Pennsylvania, Congressman Frank Clark, with a 1974 campaign budget of about $60,000, over half of it from the maritime unions, Congressman Clark was defeated by Gary Myers. His final budget was $29,000.
Now, in the case of Congressman Frank Clark, he got hurt by special interest money, not helped. But his was a rare example, even in 1974. The special interest groups are still going to make large investments as long as they can. Candidates are still going to accept them if they don't have an alternative place to get the money from. And by and large, recipients are going to be successful, not defeated. Most people who receive special interest contributions in the 74 elections were winners, not losers.
Other issues aside, the defeat of Frank Clark was a kind of local rebellion against the hard facts of political life. That incumbents, who need less money, get twice as much of it. And 7 out of 10 races are won by the candidate with the most money to spend.
Go ahead, get as close as you want. You don't have to worry about denture odor. You've got extra effervescent Polident. And Polident's got two kinds of cleaning action to help leave your dentures clean and odor-free. Polident's got one, chemical action to help clean away its stains, and two, physical action to help lift away film and odor-causing particles. So, whenever you want, get as close as you want. You've got Polident.
Great. I feel so good. I just can't wait for days like this to celebrate. Come on, world, participate. Have a silly
Posturepedic, designed in cooperation with leading orthopedic surgeons for no morning backache from sleeping on a too soft mattress.
Have a silly Posturepedic morning.
The 1974 campaign is barely over. The 76 campaign has already begun.
I have to tell you in complete candor that being elected president of the United States is not the most important thing in my life.
New faces and new approaches. The young hopefuls are being joined by a number of older campaigners, and it is campaign reform that has opened up the field. Some new rules on financing that went into effect with the start of 1975. The new law is controversial, it is complicated, and it requires decisions from every taxpayer. So we'll take it one step at a time. The first and biggest step, public financing for presidential campaigns. The fat cats and interest groups are on their way out of presidential campaign funding. By raising a basic amount of front money from the public in small contributions, a candidate can now qualify for government funds. The funds will come from existing taxes, a dollar out of whatever income tax you pay if you check the special box on the IRS form. That's for presidential elections only. For congressional campaigns, public financing was voted down, and ex-Congressman Frank Clark was one of the House majority that killed it. This was while he was still incumbent Congressman Clark.
I'm against campaign financing as far as anything is concerned except the presidential election. I don't believe that the taxpayers should pay for someone to run for Congress. And I'm not that stupid to give money to my opponent to run against me to beat me.
You acknowledge that an incumbent does have certain advantages. How do we equalize this?
I don't really know that you want to equalize it. I philosophically, now you're talking,
right.
I think perhaps if you take the political science people, that this is what they would say. But I think if a congressman is doing the job he is supposed to do for his constituents, then there is no reason in the world to be looking for another congressman.
The milder reforms that Congress adopted for its own campaigns include, first, limits on spending. But quite generous ones, $168,000 for a House campaign if there's a primary, up to $4 million for Senate races in the two biggest states, New York and California. A second change, the really crucial one, is a limit on contributions. From any individual, no more than $1,000 to any candidate per campaign, primary or final. From any group or committee, the ceiling is $5,000 or $10,000 if there's a primary. The new rules have been attacked on practically every point and on various grounds. They are being challenged in the courts by an odd alliance of conservative Senator James Buckley and liberal Democrat Eugene McCarthy. They question the new law from top to bottom, starting with the public financing feature.
I think this bill quite directly does establish two political parties and make it almost impossible for there to be an effective challenge from an independent source or from a third party of any kind.
Senator Buckley attacks the spending and fundraising limits as an infringement of freedom of political expression.
I tried to make the constitutional amendment arguments on the floor of the Senate, but you know how many people are there to listen to arguments. So I have a feeling that the political pressures, the desire to do something constructive, the feeling that the people in the country, in the light of Watergate, wanted action, resulted in people putting constitutional blinders on.
There's nothing in the Constitution that intended that because I have $1 million, I have, and you have $1, that I have 1 million times more rights in terms of choosing an elected official in this country than you do. But that's what's happened. That's the distortion.
Where some critics think campaign reform has gone too far, some insist it hasn't gone far enough.
There's a rather ironic thing about this new law. While it does a great job for presidential races, it is going to result in greater special interest money coming into the 1976 elections.
We are not going to have effective limits.
We are not.
Interest groups.
We are not. The $10,000 figure that one single individual group can give is more than enough for most races. In addition, the groups will be set up and arranged in a manner that they're going to be able to give as much money as they want to. It comes down to this. If you're going to clean up the system of financing elections in this country, you've got to get rid of the special interest givers and the big givers. But you've got to have an alternative then. There has to be some place for the money to come from, because without a sufficient amount of money for both sides to present their views, you won't have any competition. Well, we believe the place for that money to come from is from millions of Americans, each of whom are willing to pay $1 of their tax money. That's the substitute to replace the system we have now, whereby the special interest and the big givers dominate it. And that's the way to assure competition that doesn't exist today.
Whether or not public financing really is the answer for Congress, well, we'll have a chance to see as the 1976 presidential campaign develops. What seems obvious is that nobody has yet come up with any other idea that would ensure keeping special interest money out of congressional business. Just how deep the flow of special interest money continues to run is demonstrated by something that happened in Washington just lately. Like the maritime unions, trucking interests lobbied Congress for a bill, this one to allow larger rigs on highways. Like NEPA, they contributed heavily to incumbents' campaigns, concentrating on members of key congressional committees. Their bill got passed, and unlike the union's oil transportation bill, the trucker's bill got signed into law by President Ford. Besides the traffic danger, this will add perhaps $50 million a year to the taxpayers' bill for highway maintenance. And just how Byzantine this whole business of campaign finance can be may be seen from this curious fact. Some members of Congress who were unopposed in the November election collected a lot of campaign money just the same. Senator Long of Louisiana, for example, raised about $160,000. Senator Inouye of Hawaii raised $250,000. All that campaign money and nobody to campaign against. Now, that's the kind of fascinating fact that's being brought to light in the candidates' financial returns, forced into the light by new disclosure laws. In trying to reform the political campaign system, disclosure obviously was an important first step. Just as obviously, there still is a long way to go. Dan Rather for CBS Reports. Good night.
Lavoris! Lavoris?
I know you're there. I had some yesterday, and my mouth felt clean and fresh, and my breath great.
Honey, where's the Lavoris?
We don't have any.
I had some yesterday.
You were at the dentist yesterday.
You know, you're right, and my breath smelled terrific.
More dentists use Lavoris than any other mouthwash.
Which is good enough for me.
That was my last cough. That was positively my last cough. That one doesn't count. But that was absolutely my last...
Nobody can promise you'll never cough again. But you can take Vicks Formula 44 to help suppress your cough. You can't buy a more powerful cough suppressant than the one in Formula 44. It's medically recommended, yet not narcotic.
Just got to be firm and use Formula 44.
Suppress the cough you can't suppress.
Sunday afternoon, Rod Laver and Jimmy Connors battle it out for the largest tennis prize ever offered in the Challenge Cup match. 1 week from Wednesday, that talented lady named Cher heralds her new series with a big special that features Bette Midler and Elton John.